And joining me now on First Edition, we have the Finance Minister, Senator Matthias Cormann. Senator Cormann, thanks for your time. We've got a lot to talk about in terms of the economy and the mining tax particularly, but another apparent execution of an American journalist, as we saw there in our lead story this morning.
Awful and despicable, and my heart goes out to his family. It's just terrible what appears to have happened again. Australia needs to, of course, continue to work with our international partners, the United States and others, to deal with the humanitarian issues in Iraq in particular, but also to keep people secure here and abroad.
I want to turn now to domestic politics, and the Treasurer said yesterday, if people feel the mining tax deal with Clive Palmer is going to have an impact on their superannuation in the long term, they should blame Labor. Why blame Labor? You're the government.
Well, indeed, and we went to the last election promising that we would get rid of Labor's failed mining tax in order to boost investment and strengthen economic growth and create jobs. And we also said that we would get rid of all of the unfunded promises that Labor recklessly and irresponsibly attached to that failed tax. Now, this is a tax which Labor said would raise billions of dollars, and it's been costing the budget billions of dollars. Only the Labor Party can come up with a tax that actually costs the budget money, leaves the budget worse off.
But why should workers blame Labor, though? They should blame you, shouldn't they? Because you're the one who's done the deal.
Well, after Labor lost the last election, Labor should have respected our mandate. The mining tax repeal package went to the Senate twice before yesterday. Labor and the Greens combined to block our mining tax repeal legislation in the Senate twice. So what we did yesterday was to achieve the best possible deal in the national interest. We achieved the repeal of the mining tax, which is good for the economy and good for jobs. We achieved the removal of all of the unfunded promises that we said we would remove, three of them later than we would have liked, but they're all going. This has locked in $10 billion in savings over the Ford estimates, $50 billion in savings over the decade, so it helps us repair the budget, also something we said we would.
Have you delivered one promise by breaking another? You said in opposition there'd be no adverse changes, no adverse further changes to superannuation. The industry says this deal will see $128 billion less in retirement savings across the next decade. That's adverse.
Well, it's not an adverse change. And firstly, I mean, the industry, the Financial Services Council and others who've said this do not represent workers. They represent financial services institutions. What we've done is the change that we've made yesterday is leaving people with more of their own money pre-retirement. Because as Bill Shorten said in opposition, increases in compulsory super come out of people's wages. They come out of people's pockets. What we've done...
Entirely?
Well, that is what Bill Shorten said when he was the minister. I mean, the truth is they come out of a combination of wages and out of business costs. And of course, what we've done, people will be able to make decisions on their own, whether they want to use that money to pay off their mortgage faster, whether they want to use it to deal with cost of living expenses, or whether they want to use it to save more voluntarily through superannuation.
Do you really believe in compulsory super? Is this exposing a lack of support for the whole idea of it?
Not at all. We support compulsory super, and we have, of course, in the legislation yesterday, locked in the trajectory to take compulsory super to 12%. We'll get there by 2025. The truth is, I mean, the budget is not a magic pudding. I know that the Labor Party would just take one hit after the other, wasting money left, right and centre. We are committed to repairing the budget mess that we've inherited from the Labor Party, and that involves that when you incur additional expenses, and we are incurring $6.5 billion in additional expenses over the Ford estimate as a result of the delay in removing some of these measures, we are recouping that over the period to 2023 so that the amendments overall are budget neutral.
Have you any concern that you've done a deal with Clive Palmer, a mining magnate, and this is a mining tax? Do you have any concern about conflicts of interest here?
No, I don't. Mr. Palmer is the leader of a political party in the Australian Parliament. There are three Palmer United Party senators in the Senate. There is Ricky Muir from the Australian Motoring Enthusiast Party who works with the Palmer United Party. So, of course, we work with all senators represented in the Senate in a courteous and professional manner in order to achieve a consensus. And incidentally, Family First, the Liberal Democrats, also supported the agreement that we put forward. And incidentally, the Democratic Labor Party Senator John Madigan supported us bringing this on yesterday in the way we did.
So, just finally, will you be giving some advice to Peter Dutton on how to negotiate with Clive Palmer? You seem to be able to do it pretty well, and you still haven't got the GP co-payment negotiated.
Peter Dutton is an outstanding minister, and of course what we're doing as a team is work through all of the budget measures in an orderly and methodical fashion in a sequential way, prioritising the measure one after the other. And the GP co-payment, which is an important reform, is not due to come into effect until 1 July 2015, so we have a bit of time to work our way through that.
Minister, thanks for your time.
Always good to be here.